Hi, it's Steve. Today is day 5 of my 30 days of video experiment, also combined with water fasting. So I'm on my 5th day of water fasting now. I decided to shoot this one in a park near my house. I just want to spend some time outside. And it's a bit windy out now, so I'm hoping the audio comes out okay. And of course, we have a helicopter flying overhead right when I start too. But hey, we're doing this as an experiment. It's meant to be a learning experience. So every video so far, I've done in just one take, and whatever we come up with, that's what we go with. Update on the fasting. That's going well so far. My energy's coming back up today. Feeling pretty good so far. Not super energetic physically, but at least I can move around and go out for a bit of a walk. And one thing I've noticed in the past couple days is that my dreams have become extremely vivid when I'm sleeping at night. I sleep pretty well at night, and maybe wake up once in the middle of the night while I'm fasting, but my dreams are just like super crazy vivid and like so detailed and so rich and like complicated storylines throughout. And I've noticed that each time I've gone on some kind of really light type of diet. So water fasting is one thing that does it. Juice feasting, in other words, just having juice, is another thing that does it. I think I had it when I was doing a green smoothie cleanse for a week too. Also eating raw foods, so just eating 100% raw for a while, which I did for 6 months several years ago. That can also make your dreams more vivid. And to me, that's yet another sign. Hopefully these birds here aren't too distracting. For me, that's another sign that as we eat lighter, our body has more energy for other systems that it doesn't give as much attention to. If you eat animal products in particular, those are really heavy to digest, and your body has to spend to waste a lot of extra energy on digestion, because your body can't use animal protein. You can't just take, you know, cells from a cow's body or proteins from a cow's body or pigs or chickens and use them as human protein. They're not compatible. So it first has to break down animal protein into amino acids and then rebuild them into human protein. And that's an imprecise process and one that creates a lot of acid waste that also has to be cleaned up. It just sucks a lot of extra energy out from your other body systems. You don't have available so much energy for emotional awareness and empathy and creative thinking, spiritual awareness. And so, all these systems that were previously operating at a pretty low level, they get upgraded. And you suddenly become really emotionally aware, more empathic. You're able to tell what, you know, people are feeling in a richer way than you ever have before. It's pretty amazing all the systems that get amped up. You get sick less often. When I ate raw for 6 months, I didn't get sick at all during that time. I've met raw foodists who haven't been sick in decades. And I believe them too, because it's your immune system is one of those systems that gets compromised when you eat too heavily. And that system gets much stronger when you eat lighter. Foods that are easier to digest. Plant foods, their proteins come naturally in the form of amino acids, which your body can immediately build up into human protein. And so you don't have to have that process of breaking it down first and having it be wasteful. And again, it's an imprecise process. Your body's going to have to activate its immune system to clean up all the undigested animal protein in your system. It really messes you up in ways you don't realize until you do something extremely purist for a while, like a month, and then you notice the difference immediately. But if you've been eating the same way, you know, or same types of foods your whole life, and you never experienced what it's like to, say, eat 100% raw for a month, you're in for a real treat. You're in for a real surprise. That's what made me really want to pursue detoxification and more dietary purity as I've gone along. And I certainly haven't been 100% purist. I definitely indulge now and then. I don't indulge in any animal products, but, you know, I'll indulge in sweets or richer foods, you know, fatty foods now and then, especially when I'm traveling. And that's you know, it's something I like for balancing my life and having interesting experiences too. And you know, then I'll go through really purist experiences and sort of cleanse from that if I feel like I'm overdoing it. So this year in particular, I'm trying to be more purist. So I'm not doing any alcohol, not doing any caffeine. That means no coffee, no decaf coffee, because that still has some trace amounts of caffeine. No white tea, no green tea, no black tea, and no chocolate. No raw cacao either. So no stimulants, and no alcohol. So, you know, it's because I want to operate on a more pure pure level this year and see what that's like. Let's really see if I can take my health, especially my mental clarity, my emotional awareness, to a new level. And that's one of the reasons I'm doing this water fast earlier this year. The main topic, though, I want to talk about is taking time off. Taking time off from work, taking vacation time. And this is something that, especially in the USA, we have a really sad culture of, you know, about the merits of taking vacation time. Like, you know, typically, you know, we might be okay with taking 2-3 weeks off a year, and some people take less than that. Whereas in other cultures, you know, a month or more, a year, 2 months, that's pretty normal. At this point in my life, I typically take off, you know, and go travel about 3 months out of each year. And, you know, and that has been a really richly valuable part of my life. It's done a lot for my work and my productivity. And the counterintuitive thing to get about this is that taking more time off is almost always better for your productivity. You'll get more done, you'll have more creative ideas, you'll think bigger, you'll set better goals, just more mental clarity when you take time completely away from work and don't work for long stretches at a time. And that was the thing, I did not get it all in my 20s. In my 20s, I rarely took vacations once I got into work mode, and I would just, you know, work for years and really feel like burned out a lot of time. And I'd find myself doing the equivalent of taking mini vacations instead and not being fully engaged with my work. And one time I actually measured my work productivity. Like, I measured how many hours I was in my home office, and I measured how many of those hours were really core productive work that needed to be done. And I came up with that I was spending 60 hours a week in my office, and I was actually really working on the good productive stuff 15 of those hours. So my productivity ratio was 25%. And I measured it another week, and it was like the same result, pretty close to it. And I thought, this is pathetic. You know, what am I doing with those other 45 hours? And it was just like doing excess busy work that really didn't need to be done. I wasn't thinking of the clear priorities I need to be attending to. And so instead, I decided, well, you know what? I'm just gonna be like in my office 25 hours this week. And I think I worked for, you know, on good productive stuff for 20 of those hours. I'm not sure if I'm getting the numbers exactly right. I wrote an article on this many years ago, but, you know, I was like, hey, I just worked 5 more productive hours and I saved myself, what, you know, many more, what, you know, 35 wasted hours in my office. And then I could use that time for other personal pursuits, you know, exploring different goals and things like that. And so that's been a lesson I've really learned. I would encourage you, if you're like in this all-out work mode and you haven't taken a vacation in a long time, haven't taken time off, measure how productive you are. Like, just, you can do this with various software. I don't do that. I just use pen and paper. So I just write down the times where I start any new activity. You can be really anal about it and record every time you get up and go to the bathroom or get some water or something like that. I just do it when it's going to be at least a meaningful, you know, shift. Like, if I'm changing something for 5 minutes or more, 15 minutes or more, something like that. So if I start checking email or web browsing, I record that. And I just let myself do what I feel naturally compelled to do. But almost always, just the very act of measuring this is going to change your results. You'll find yourself improving just by measuring it. And you might get some sad truths there coming through when you see how little real core productive work you're actually getting done in a full workday. And especially, I encourage you to measure this over the course of a week or two, because sometimes, you know, individual days can be skewed a bit. Especially, you know, work days that are typical for you. And get that data and see what it looks like and figure out how many of those hours that, you know, you're in your office or at your workspace, you're actually doing something productive that needs to be done, that's a clear priority for you, that's moving the needle forward for you in life. And then also notice where you're just doing busy work that, you know, like being excessively wordy and answering emails or responding to emails that don't require a response at all, or doing idle web surfing, and that's not really moving the needle for you in life. And, you know, notice that difference. And also notice when you're just flat out procrastinating, like you're, you know, playing video games or something like that, and you're really taking mini vacations inside your workday. And I find that what happens when we don't take enough time off, we end up taking it anyway, but we steal it from the time we tell ourselves we're working. and we get into a phase of being in denial about that. And that's certainly, I think, where I was in much of my 20s. I wasn't always as productive as I could have been. And as I got older, I, you know, met other people who were super productive, and I found that many of them just worked 4-day work weeks. Some of them worked with a pattern of something like 1 week on and then 1 week off, or they work hard for a few weeks and then they take an extended period of a few weeks to go travel and take time off. And the excuse I always used is that, okay, I was broke. I didn't have money to travel. I didn't have money to, you know, take time off. I always had to be working. I felt like I would be guilty, you know, especially I'm married at the time and I'm thinking I have to keep working because I've got to support my family and, you know, all that. And so much, I hear that same thing, especially from many men that I meet, and it's so much BS. We're not going to be productive under the circumstances when we're just, you know, burning the candle at both ends and wearing ourselves down, and you don't realize how fatigued you are and how much your motivation has sunk until you take time off. And I mean like a real vacation, at least 2 weeks, like not even a week. You know, I find when I get traveling, a week is cool, it's a short break, but a week just gets me into travel mode. It's only like in the second week that I'm really starting to enjoy it and soak up its richness and get the benefits of it. And, you know, when I think about my 20s, the worst part of it is that I don't have all the rich memories that I got later in life, like especially during my 40s. For the past several years, I've had some just beautiful and amazing memories traveling to, you know, many different countries. I've been to Europe 6 times in the past 6 years, and you know, been to many different countries there. Last year, went to Mexico, spent I think about 2.5 weeks there, spent some time in Costa Rica, and where else? Went to Canada yet again, went to the UK, went to Italy, spent 30 days in California, and you know, these create just beautiful and amazing memories. And when I look back on the past several years of my life, I see tremendous richness. And what that does is it makes me even more motivated and excited to continue my lifestyle as it is. I don't feel like I'm any more in that mode like I was in my 20s, where I have to work to then earn vacation time. And that's a real difference. It's like, to me, vacation time is a necessity. It's not a luxury. And I think many Americans especially get that in their minds, that vacation is a luxury and that that's the thing you have to sacrifice when you know, when you're stressed, when your money's short. And you know, I just think that's a terribly wrong mindset. In fact, you know, if you do some Google searching on this or read people's books about it, you'll find there's all kinds of creative ways to travel where you can do so for free or very low cost. You know, like I said, I've been to Europe 6 times, and I only paid for the first trip to go. The other 5 trips were all paid for by somebody else. It became something that I integrated into my lifestyle. I would get a speaking engagement there, and that would get me started off with traveling. You know, on those trips, I'd get invited to speak in some city and have a place to stay for a while, and the, you know, the conference organizer would pay for the flights. And then after I was there, I would say, well, you know what, I'm not going to fly back right away. Let me just keep traveling while I'm here. And, you know, I challenged myself too, even though I could afford to pay for places, and I've stayed in 5-star hotels before, and I really don't find it that big a deal. I don't get that much joy or excitement out of that. I get the most joy or excitement actually out of staying with locals and getting to meet new people. I prefer it just sleeping in a, you know, in a spare bedroom in some place or on a friend's couch. Usually when Rochelle and I travel together, we like doing Airbnb. I can afford more, but I just feel like I get a better experience when I go to places and live like a local. Or we just go from invitation to invitation. So like one time I went to Europe and traveled around for 5 weeks, and I just went from invitation to invitation and never paid for a place to stay. Another time, more recently, I think it was about 3.5 weeks of traveling through Europe doing the same thing. Just, you know, people would, I'd meet them at a conference and they'd invite me to go stay with them, maybe in a neighboring country, go visit there, and then another invitation would come up and go visit there, and it'd be fun just hopscotching around. And what I realized is that there's different ways to hold wealth. We, you know, tend to think of wealth in financial terms or having assets that we own. And that's only one form of wealth. That's a transactional form of wealth where we end up trading what we own, you know, which is basically social debt. Money is just social debt. It's an IOU from society. We end up trading that IOU back for some kind of value. Well, another form of holding wealth is goodwill. You know, if people are friendly and they're just being generous and nice to you, and they offer you a place to stay, or you know, offer you a chance to have a new experience with them, that is a form of wealth too. And that form of wealth doesn't get developed so much when you're sitting at your desk working all the time. That form of wealth gets developed when you go out into the world and you explore other cultures and you develop your social skills and you develop your emotional awareness more, and you learn to connect with people and create good connections with them when you're just meeting them. You know, can you meet somebody and within the first hour or two, they're inviting you to stay with them for a week or so? I mean, I have that experience all the time now. The people I did the meetup with yesterday morning, one invited me to go, you know, stay with him in Barcelona. So I've never been to Barcelona. I've been to Spain before, but not Barcelona. So I thought, you know, maybe someday I'll take him up on that offer. And this kind of stuff shows up all the time, but it wasn't showing up when I was just like in work mode. Even with all the blogging, you know, you might think it's because I have a high traffic website or all the blogging I've done. That kind of stuff really wasn't coming through. It was only when I started connecting with people socially in person that those kinds of invites show up. People tend not to invite strangers to stay with them just over the internet, but those invitations will show up in person a lot. And so I had to take the first step. Like, I had to pay for that first Europe trip myself, and it was really difficult. You know, it felt like some kind of crazy alien experience, and now it just seems like no big deal at all. You know, so what if it's a 10-hour flight? No big deal. I used to think that was crazy, like to spend that much time on a plane. I couldn't imagine who would do that sort of thing. And this, you know, this has just added such a collection of beautiful memories that, you know, I really regret how I lived in my 20s, because when I think of the memories I have from my 20s, I remember spending a lot of time at my office. I had an office outside the home for many of those years, and I just remember, you know, work. I have lots of memories of just sitting at my desk working and feeling stressed, worrying about, you know, business projects and things like that. I just think, looking back, that's disappointing. If I had my 20s to do all over again, I would not work so much. I would make myself take like 2-3 months off every year to just go travel, minimum. And I know some people take that even further, and they become digital nomads. And I've been sorely tempted to do that too, to sell my house and just go fully nomadic. And I didn't, because I also like the stability of having a stable place. There's sometimes where I just want to be in work mode in one place, and I don't find myself being as productive usually when I'm traveling. I find it pretty hard to work on the road and be as productive as I am in my home office, where I have everything set up the way I want, where I have a bigger monitor to use, and you know, and so on, all the equipment the way I like. So, you know, I'm just sharing these ideas with you, and in case this resonates with you. And you know, how do you take that first step? How do you, you know, get yourself to start taking time off? And the truth is, I think you just have to force yourself to do it. Like, actually force yourself to take a long trip, a 2-week trip, and sometimes there'll be consequences, and you just have to accept those consequences. I think, you know, once you do 2 weeks, then try to go 3 weeks, try to go 30 days or more. See if you can be away from home for 30 days. And again, it's going to feel very forced in the beginning. What you'll notice though, especially if you do creative work, is that while you're on vacation, so many different kind of benefits pile up. You'll start thinking more creatively, you'll get a different perspective on your work, and probably when you get back to work, you'll be super motivated. And if you're not super motivated when you get back, that's a hint and a half you're in the wrong line of work. If you're not missing your work while you're on vacation, then, you know, as if you'd miss your family if you're away from them for a while, then I think that's a real strong hint that you need to face a career change, you know, coming up here. So there, you know, a lot of this incubation of creative ideas and awareness about your relationship with your work, whether it's time for a career change, this is the kind of thing that doesn't come up when you're sitting at your desk, but it does come up when you're on vacation having different experiences and you finally allow that part of your brain to rest and rejuvenate. And then you know, you may find yourself very drawn in different directions. And the real key here is creating a lifestyle and a work balance that you're really happy with. And when you come up with something you're really happy with and you love it and you like working and you like, you know, being on vacation and traveling and having new experiences, and you have a beautifully balanced life there, it makes you just more motivated all across the board. It just makes you happier as a human being, more pleasant to be around. You know, I always feel a bit dragged down when I'm around the people who haven't made that type of transition yet, where, you know, you can tell their work and their stresses are weighing so heavily on them. And they think that the solution is going to become by digging deeper into the pit they've dug for themselves. And that's not where the solution comes from. The solution comes from taking time off, taking a break, getting some fresh perspective, and it's creating amazing memories that enrich your life. And that makes you want to raise your standards across the board. When you have really rich travel experiences, it makes you want to get that same kind of juice out of your work life as well. And if your work life isn't paying off as well, you really feel it more deeply. You feel it dragging you down. So it's, you know, this isn't a really complicated topic, but I wanted to share it because in particular for my fellow Americans, I think it's one you guys really need to hear. And you know, if you're the type of person that's stuck and you've gone like months or even years without taking a vacation, take a freaking vacation. Take time off. You know, whatever you have to do to arrange that, force it, make it happen, and you'll thank me later. You'll see the difference. I'll see you tomorrow.